All right. We are live. Welcome to this much anticipated 5 p.m. happy hour here at my house. And of course, it's happy hour everywhere. Or at least it's happy hour somewhere. But I have a feeling it's happy hour where you guys are at too. So welcome. It's good to see everybody joining us here. This is going to be very laid back, very easy, a lot of fun. As I fill my fat face with my apple right now. You're like, come on, Rock. You told me about the cheat meals. You told me about the Terramana. I got it all. And I'm assuming that you guys have it all too. I told you guys, bring your cheat meals, bring your favorite liquid, your favorite beverage, and it is all welcome today because this is a much needed reprieve that we have, that we've earned, you know, considering everything that's been going on around the world at this time. So, anyway, I want to welcome you guys. Hello, hello, a lot of hellos. Do I speak Spanish? I do. Ay, papi. That's the only thing I know. I don't know. And I haven't even started drinking yet. So we have that to look forward to is my Spanish. I love you back. Thank you. You know what? I feel very smart because I have this going. I have my computer going too at the same time. Taking questions from you guys. How's everybody doing during this time? How is everybody? What's going on? I hope you guys are doing well as can be during this time. This has been obviously a very trying time. It's a very concerning time, but also a time for us to come together, also a time for us to be vigilant and disciplined, and also a time for us to try our best to stay positive. But, okay, speaking of positive, let's do something that I've been waiting for. I know you guys have too. I have the brioche French toast for my cheat meal. And as you guys know, cheat meals for me have been part of my life for many, many years. And cheat meals are also, for me, just one of those times that I welcome and I embrace usually once a week. And usually it's around 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock in the morning, usually on Sunday nights when everybody is asleep. The house is quiet, including the dog, and it's just me. It's my documentaries, whatever I'm watching, and my cheat meal. So I have my French toast there. I'm gonna crush this in a second with you guys. Well, maybe not in a second. It depends on how much I drink with you. But let's kick this show off on the road. I'm going to make a drink, and I hope you guys are going to make a drink too. I'm going to make a Terramana Margarita, as now I've been appropriately calling a Terramana Quarantina Margarita. Starts with Terramana Blanco. Pop this top here. No chance of survival. You are right. This has no chance of survival. Neither does that French toast. So what we'll do first is... here. What are you guys drinking? Let me know. You guys on some wine? You're on some Terramana? A lot of you guys have your Terramana out there. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thank you for all the love you've been giving Terramana too. I really appreciate that. I'm glad you find it amazing. A lot of comments that it's been the best tequila you guys have ever tasted. I'm sure that's been after your fourth or fifth shot, but thank you very much. We put a lot of work behind it. Let's see. Supposed to start off with about, as I tell bartenders, about 2 ounces, but, I failed math, so I don't know. I think it feels like about 2 ounces. We go with the Terramana Blanco, and we'll go with a little bit of lime juice. Italy is in the house. What's up, Italy? Supposed to be about half an ounce maybe, but this is going on taste too, so whatever your tastes are. Raw agave, also very important. And so just a little bit. There we go. So a little bit of raw agave, a little bit of my favorite, a little bit of pineapple juice. What's up, Australia? Good to see you. Hope you guys are staying strong down there as best you can. Again, as I talk to the bartenders, it's usually about a quarter ounce of pineapple, but again, it's all to taste. Whatever your palate enjoys. What's up, England? It's good to see you. I know you guys are trying to stay as disciplined as you can. You got a lot of friends over there. Shake it up a little bit more. Nice. Second pour. There we go. All right. There we go. All right. A little bit of wine. Bear with me here. This is what it's like if we're drinking together, and I'm making drinks, by the way, with you guys. There we go. Just a little bit of wine here. All right, let's kick this off. What's up, BJ? Britt Johnson, my sis. Just a splash. Knife, maybe. Finger always works. My fingers are clean, usually. All right, turn this down for a second. All right, the very first toast goes to this one goes to all the nurses and all the doctors and all the healthcare physicians and everyone on the front line in the medical field. And all the hard work that you guys are putting in, especially during this time of uncertainty, and as you guys are literally risking your lives too, as well as you have families and babies at home that you're trying to take care of, as well as trying to take care of everybody who's being admitted into the hospitals. This one is for you. I cheers and I toast, a Terramana toast to you, and I thank you guys. I love you. Please hang in there, and you have all of our support. Cheers. That's good. That is good. All right. Give me some questions. Let's start talking here. Salute to all in front lines. Very true. You're raising your glass to Shirley Temple in solidarity. I hear you. Cheers, Brazil. So I have a few questions here that are coming in. Where did I get the name Terramana from? What's up, Brazil? Good to see you. Where did I get the name Terramana from? So Terramana Tequila, I got the name from, it is a mixture. It is of the earth. It is a spirit of the earth. So Terra in Spanish is red dirt, earth, and mana is the Polynesian spirits that guide us all. So I wanted to combine two cultures that I hold so dear and close to my heart, and the Mexican culture as well as our Polynesian culture. So the name Terramana became the name of the tequila. We had started a spirits company called Siete Bucks Spirits, and of this company, the very first expression is our Terramana tequila. The Blanco is fantastic. And again, thank you guys. Thank you guys for those of you who do have it. Thank you. I'm glad you enjoy it. And also, I do want to take a moment to say thank you to Southern Glazer Wine and Spirits. My good friend, Wayne Chaplin, who's the CEO Sits on the board. University of Miami, became very good friends with my business partner, Danny Garcia. We've known Wayne for years. He's been really instrumental in his company, of which employs over, I believe, 20,000 people, working extremely hard right now to get not only Terramana, but all the spirits that they deliver to all the mom and pop local businesses, local liquor store businesses who continue to stay open, as they are essential. Yes, they are. So thank you guys so much for your work, and thank you to all the mom and pop businesses out there who are not only supporting Terramana, but staying open. I'm so happy that you guys are able to stay open, as I have shaken your hands, many of you all across the country. I'm so happy that you are able to stay open during this time, and I'm also well aware and very empathetic to those of you guys who aren't working right now and the concerns that you have. So please hang in there. We are going to get this through this thing. And again, cheers. Okay. Here we go. A lot of great questions. Thank you guys so much. What's on the menu tonight? Well, on the menu tonight is why does it look like my hair is growing out? I know it is. It's just amazing. What's on the menu tonight is I have the brioche French toast for our cheat meal, and I'm going to take you through that one too as well. It's a personal recipe that I have that is pretty damn good, and really enjoyed it. It's been fantastic, and I think you guys are going to enjoy it too. What am I drinking? Come on, you got to get with it. I'm drinking Terramana. Terramana tequila. It's the Terramana Quarantina Margarita that I made, but it is, what's up, Portugal? Good to see you guys. Well, the best workout routine that I have, really, you know, I have a few workout routines, but I think, you know, what I've been trying to do now and trying to encourage a lot of you guys who don't have a gym, and it's millions and millions of you out there who don't have a gym, and my heart is with you, because I know what the gym means to you guys, and I know what training and working out means to you guys. So you got to be as creative as you possibly can in the house, outside, as much as you possibly can. And I know it's very, very difficult, but pretty soon, hopefully sooner than later, you know, our businesses are going to get back up and open again, and the gyms are going to open again. You guys are going to be able to really start training and really getting after it. But I feel you, and I completely understand. I completely understand the kind of training. I'm a lucky son of a bitch that I'm able to. I've had my personal gym for many, many years now, and you know, if I didn't have that personal gym, that I'm able just to go out and, you know, work out a lot of this frustration and work out my rage. I'm not quite too sure what I would do. So I feel you guys. Stay positive. And what is Emily Blunt like to work with in real life? I'm sure that's Emily's assistant who just texted me that. What's up, Brie? Emily Blunt is great. I love Emily. We're very, very good friends. As you guys know, we did Jungle Cruise together. She's a tequila lover. Her and her husband, John. They love Terramana, too. You guys better be breaking it out tonight. Emily is great. She is, you know, one of the greatest actresses, I believe, of this time. And very smart, brilliant. She's awesome in Jungle Cruise. I can't wait for you guys to see the movie. She is truly the female version of Indiana Jones. And so proud of her and the performance that she delivered in the movie. And the movie, our Jungle Cruise, was supposed to come out this July. Not quite too sure if it's still going to come out in July. We'll see. I have a sense of what's going to happen. But we'll see. It all depends on, you know, how things, if we're able to flatten this curve, if we're able to get our theaters up and running again, and, you know, kind of getting into a nice, robust place. But I also think what's really important, I think, for not only Jungle Cruise and just for the movie business, I just want to see our consumers, customers, people, audience. I just want to make sure that you guys have the emotional confidence. We all have the emotional confidence to get back in theaters again. So we'll see what happens. But Emily, she's one of my favorite human beings. And this one's for you, Toots. All right. What's up, Flex Lewis? You are the man, multi-time Mr. Olympia. How are you, brother? Good to see you. You guys are able to hear this Sweet Home Chicago from Keb Mo. He's one of my favorite artists, Corey Harris. What's up, JJ Watt? Where is the French toast? What's up, Sports Center? JJ, it's here. You gotta take your time. You just can't just dive right into it. Listen, I know you're one of the greatest football players of all time, future Hall of Famer and everything that you are. All right, the French toast is coming. did I ever consider, what's up, Simi Singh? There you are. I'm going to eat the cheat meal. Yes, woman, I'm going to get to that. Malo Uso, yes, good to see you too. What's up, Michael Blackson? I love how Michael Blackson gives me the whitest thumbs up. Cheers, brother. What chance does the Justice League have against an angry Black Adam? What's that term? No chance in hell. Very excited about Black Adam, by the way. I've been training very, very hard for that role. We were supposed to start shooting it in the summer in July, and you know, we'll see. I'm not quite too sure if it's still going to happen, but or at least we start shooting in July. But it will all work out the way it's meant to work out, so we'll see. Oh, look, my mom is in the house. Don't drink tequila while you're talking. I know, Mom. Can't help it, especially when Sam Cooke comes on. This is it. All right. First alcohol I'm drinking, I'm drunk. No. It takes a lot more than that. Maya Lazary, how are you keeping the babies busy? That's a good question. You know, like a lot of you guys out there, as we are kind of dealing with, not kind of dealing with it, as we are dealing with this, you know, one of the things that us as parents are tasked with is to not only keep our babies and our children very busy, but also just as important as keeping them busy is making sure that they're not feeling any kind of disruption in their life. It's okay for us as adults to feel the disruption. We deal with it. We manage with it. We manage it. But we want to keep that clear of our babies, and we want to make sure that they still have peace and they still have harmony and they are not feeling any kind of disruption. So we are doing playtime. We are doing story time. We are doing school time. And, you know, we have a four-year-old, and our little baby Tia is getting ready to turn, she's getting ready to turn two, coming up here in about a week or so. So, you know, right now we've been doing lessons at home, and I know you guys around the world are doing this too. Our first lesson is about family, next lesson is about sharing, next lesson is about how daddy is so handsome and sexy. No, that's inappropriate. That's kind of true, though. And we also did a fun one, which was Daddy's job and what Daddy does. And you know, I got to tell you guys, as much as we're dealing with this crisis, and as stressful as it can be, because truly it's the unknown, and we're not quite too sure what tomorrow looks like. Although we are hopeful, and we are holding on to that fundamental quality of faith. It's still tough, but I got to tell you that, you know, the silver lining, one of the silver linings in this and the blessing is just being able to spend more time at home. I've been a pretty busy guy, for many, many years. So I've been enjoying this time at home. Certainly been enjoying this time at home. All right. French toast time. Oh, somebody's birthday, I see. James J. Jefferson, good to see you, brother. You gotta have faith. Faith in tequila. Hiram, good to see you, too. D, your artwork is always amazing. It's painting time. I got you. Love to you and the fam, too, as well. All right. So, while you're like, Jesus Christ, look at that French toast. I know. Here we go. So This is my brioche French toast, and it's a recipe that's kind of an evolved recipe. There are a lot of chefs who we enjoy working with over the years, and we have a core group of chefs kind of all across the country who we lean on and, you know, ask, hey, can you guys create this recipe and send it over? Between Chef Janet and Chef Evelyn and Chef Rob and Chef Rocky out in L.A. Cool name, Chef Rocky. Oh, these are funny. Yes, my cheat meal game is very strong. So, yes, so this is brioche French toast. So what I have asked, this that I have asked, because I am greedy, is this is a four-inch thick slices. All right, let's start at the beginning. Brioche, two loaves of brioche French bread. The music stopped. Hold on 1 second. Second here. Can't have the music stop. There we go. Little Lionel. But before we get in the French toast. It's a terrible amount of time. So yes, these are big pieces. So the Terramana French toast. So I'm sorry, the Terramana French toast. The like, damn, Rock, this is only the third drink. The brioche French toast, it's 4-inch. It's supposed to be about 2 ounces. It's 4-inch cut slices with about a lot of eggs. So basically, so the thing with this recipe is, a lot of times with French toast, what a lot of chefs, and they are artists and they're amazing, is sometimes for me and my palate, the French toast tastes a little heavy sometimes. Heavy with creams and butters and milks and things like that. So I wanted to dial it back. So this French toast is brioche French bread, and the brioche has a little bit of sweetness to it, which is really nice. It has a good quality, a good sweet quality that starts off with your base. Eggs, milk, cinnamon, a little bit of butter in the pan, so you get a little bit of that. You get a little bit of that that kind of buttery toast to it, and out comes the DJ version of the French toast. All right, where's my agave? There it is. Put it all in here. There we go. What would I say the best pizza on the planet is? You know, I love pizza. What's up, Jill? Good to see you. Jill Flanders. I hope you're doing well. She's representing $7. I hope you're feeling better. And so the best pizza on the planet, look, I mean, that's hard to say, but I know there's a couple of great places. There's a place where, you know, down where we used to live down in South Florida, there's a place called Pizza Heaven. It's one of my favorite places. You go in there, you could always ask, give me what the Rock has ordered for the past decade. And they have become good friends of ours. His name is Frank. He owns the place. And we no longer live in that area, but that is a great place, Pizza Heaven. So basically, you know, what I used to love to do, and I still do, but you got to find the right pizza makers to do this. I like to double dough it. So if you are pizza lovers out there and you like a thick crust pizza, not deep dish, but a thick crust pizza, tell your pizza maker to double dough it. So basically, you take two large pieces of dough, large pizza doughs, put them together, you knead them together, and you make your pizza out of that. It is incredible, and it is amazing. And so there's also some really good places in New York. There's also some good places in Connecticut, too, as well. So it kind of all depends. But I'm a New York pizza guy. So, you know, in this place down in South Florida, Pizza Heaven, they They're New York family, so nice Italian family. So yeah, I would say that. I know. What's up, Russia? Double the calories, yes. All right, here we go. So, hold on here. One second. So you notice I do have the peanut butter in my hand. Here we go. So what I do love to do is smother this French toast with peanut butter. Any kind of peanut butter, it doesn't matter. Whatever your favorite is, your peanut butter of choice. Peanut butter, almond butter, duck butter. It's just a Terramana tequila talking at this point. So got my peanut butter. I got the maple syrup. Here we go. What is my favorite movies of all time? Well, favorite movie of all time? That's a good question. So I have a few of them that are my favorite movies. One would be, I love The Godfather, the original Godfather. I love Coal Miner's Daughter with Sissy Spacek, a story about Loretta Lynn. And my friends are going to get me for this one, but I love It's a Wonderful Life. So I would say those movies, and of course, Indiana Jones, the very first Raiders of the Lost Ark, Jaws. You know, I grew up, I'm an 80s baby, grew up then watching movies, and so I'm a Spielberg kid, so I love a lot of his movies. What's up, Hiram Garcia? Lewis Howes, how you doing, buddy? Hiram Garcia says, hush puppies. Yeah, inside joke. Cannot speak in Persian, no, but I have a lot of Persian friends. Am I going to get drunk on camera? Well, I might. No, of course not. I can hold my liquor. Yes, I see you. Good to see you guys. A lot of people. Good to see you. Cheers. What's up, India? You guys hang in there. You guys hang in there. All right. What's up, Gold Coast? I miss you guys. I loved it out there. Will I ever take over the Super Bowl again? You know what? I'm taking a moment for this. Because this shit is amazing. Highly recommend this. It's amazing. Let me just show you what that looks like. You can see that. Amazing. Will I ever take over the Super Bowl again? Look, I had the best time. We had just an amazing time at the Super Bowl this year for Fox. I introduced the team, the AFC champions, the NFC champions, the 49ers, the Chiefs. Was just really, truly amazing. And we also had just an amazing Terramana tequila spot. Which was just really, really so cool. And I look forward to doing it again. Yeah, maybe we'll do it the next Super Bowl. We'll see. You know, I got to tell you, a lot of you guys know, but, me playing pro football, that was my dream to play in the NFL. It never happened for me. A lot of my friends went on to play in the NFL. A lot of my friends went on to become the greatest of all time. At their positions, but no, that never happened for me. So it was actually me playing in the NFL and making it to the NFL was actually the best thing that never happened. So that was a dream come true. So I live vicariously through all my players now. So it was a real honor to introduce them. I had a great, great time. It was amazing. Did you get around to singing Tay Tay? Taylor's my buddy. She's great. I don't know if you guys saw her last video. That was her first directing debut, was The Man. And I was able to voice The Man for her. And it was really cool. Might get around to. All right, what are you guys eating? Tell me, what's happening? That's good. Thank you, Lewis, for that question. What's the greatest lesson that my dad taught me? Well, the greatest lesson that my dad taught me, my dad, as many of you may know or may not know, he passed away suddenly. One second. He passed away suddenly, January 15th of this year. And he taught me a lot of lessons, a lot of life lessons. My dad and I had a very complicated relationship, like a lot of men I know have with their fathers. It's that testosterone thing. But, you know, obviously we loved each other, and I adored my dad when I was younger. And then later on in life, that adoration turned to respect. And empathy and understanding. So, greatest lesson my dad taught me? The greatest lesson my dad taught me was respect is given when it's earned. So, go out and earn it. That was the greatest lesson that he taught me. He actually said, respect is given when it's earned. So, get your ass out there and earn it. That's how he said it. So, what lessons do I want to teach my daughters? Well, that's a great question. The lessons that I want to teach my daughters are the lessons of the value of hard work, the value of appreciating and earning a dollar, and really the value of empathy, the value of love, the value of family. And I think the value of failure and embracing failure. We're all going to fail at some point, and they're going to fall down and they're going to fail, but that's okay because those are life lessons, and we get back up from those and we move forward and we become better. So I'm so proud of all my daughters, Simone and Jasmine and baby Tia. Simone is kicking ass down there at NXT at the training program for the WWE at the Performance Center. She's doing such a great job. I'm really proud of her. As she's trying to balance being a full-time student and also being a full-time student for professional wrestling at NXT in the Performance Center. Again, so it's a very, very difficult thing that she's trying to balance, but she's doing a great job, and I'm proud of her. And Jazzy's doing great as a four-year-old. She's running the roost. She's jumping on me like she's doing the Superfly Snooker Splash on me nightly. We play rough. And Tia, of course, is just the best. So amazing. A couple more questions. Thank you guys so much for all these questions, by the way. I hope you guys are enjoying your cheat meals. Clearly, I'm not putting a dent in this, but I am putting a dent in this. This is good. Since gyms are closed, do I think resistance workouts are effective? I do. I do think that resistance workouts are effective. And I think that, you know, this is a time where we have to get creative. You guys do have to get creative as you are trying to figure out, you know, what kind of workouts you guys are doing, what kind of physical activity you guys are doing. I get it. I know what it's like not to be able to train. Fortunately, I do have my gym now, and I train very, very hard. I train for all of us. If you guys want care to live vicariously through me as I train, just know that I am working very, very hard because I'm not taking this for granted. I don't take this fact that I can train for granted. So I want these gyms to open as fast as they possibly can so you guys can get back to working out as fast as you possibly can too as well. A lot of questions, when am I going to post my workout? No, I'm not going to post my workouts. At least not now. I just don't feel like I'm very sensitive. I think I might be oversensitive as it relates to, you know, I just don't want to be that asshole who's like, hey, look at the great workouts I'm having in my gym. Look at this, guys. You guys do the best you can because I'm going to go have this, you know, incredible workout. I just don't want to be that guy. So I am just know that I'm training very hard. I got a lot of rage. Rage against the dying of the light. Quote my favorite poet, Dylan Thomas. Another question. As a teen in college, did you ever have any summer jobs? That's good. Yes, I did. So I had one job in college. My first semester home in college, I worked at Costco. And I was a cart collector at Costco. And I know what you guys are thinking. Like, I'm sorry, Rock. Did you say card collector? No, I said cart collector. And I had this bright-ass orange, like, vest on, indicating, I guess, that I was the one who was collecting the carts. I don't know if the car collectors are still wearing the bright ass orange vest that I did, but I was a car collector in college, and that job lasted all of one day. I was like, I'm out. No, I'm not. Fuck this noise. It just wasn't for me. And then throughout my college career, I actually painted houses and I prepped houses to be painted. So I did construct that kind of get my hands dirty kind of work. There was a really good guy. His name is Bruce, and I hope I get his last name right. It's Gibson. He gave me a job every summer, and I really appreciate that because as full-time student athletes, we didn't get any money, and we were all just piss broke down at the University of Miami. And I was very fortunate that, you know, he paid me every summer, and I worked my ass off in that hot-ass sun, but, you know, he really took care of me. So, Bruce, if you're out there, thank you, man. I appreciate you taking care of me back then when I needed it. Any more Hobbs and Shaw films? Yes. We have, we are developing now the next film, the next Hobbs movie. I'm pretty excited about it. We're really excited about it too. Just got to figure out the creative right now and the direction we're going to go. But thank you guys, around the world for really making that one such a huge success. We almost made, I think, $750 million or something crazy like that. I just want to say thank you guys so much because that was a big one. That was the big spinoff that hopefully, you know, if that did not succeed, then they weren't going to continue any kind of spinoff identity for Fast and Furious. So luckily it did succeed, and now they're talking about a spinoff for the female characters, which I'm very excited about. And I know that Vin Diesel is going to produce that one, which I'm really excited about because it's about time that the girls have their own franchise and spinoff, which is very cool. And so thank you guys very much for that. I appreciate it. Love you back, Philly. Brad Slater. I need that question again, man. Hobbs Junket was legendary. Thank you. Good to see you, brother. What is my Tony Baker comedy, that French toast? What's up, buddy? Good to see you. What's up, Kurdistan? Good to see you. Yes, so I will tell you, thank you, Brad Slater, for that question. Before I made it to the bright lights of the WWE and the global success that the WWE is, I started in a small wrestling company down in Memphis, called the USWA, and my guarantee every single night was $40. That was our guarantee, wrestling for the USWA, and our guarantee was $40 per match. And I would wrestle in flea markets every Monday and state fairs, the Nashville State Fair every Saturday night, in front of 200 people, maybe 300, maybe. So to supplement my income at the intermissions, so I had a guarantee of $40 per match. So I knew that I could guarantee that was going to be in my pocket, $40. But to supplement my income, what I used to do is during intermission, I used to go out into the crowd, and a few of us would do this, and we would go to where the we called it the gimmick table. And this is where you sold like your pictures and your little trinkets that had your name on them for fans. And the big money maker for me was I had my own Polaroid camera, and I would charge $5 if somebody wanted to take a picture with me. And on a good night, I could clear $50. So on a good night, I could walk away with almost $100. And that was a big deal when you're starving, but you're also cutting your teeth and you're learning the wrestling business and how important it is. And by the way, my story isn't independent of anybody else. Every single wrestler who have gone on to be the greatest of all time, from Stone Cold Steve Austin to Macho Man Randy Savage, you name it, everybody has gone through the Memphis territory of the USWA. All of us starved, making $40 per match, and everyone selling their gimmicks. So I wasn't the only one. But I'll never forget those days, because those days, by the way, when I was living, I rented out a little room in Memphis, Tennessee, on Union, right off of Union. And it was cool for me because I'm a big fan of music, and I was a big fan of Johnny Cash and Elvis Presley and Jerry Lee Lewis, and Sun Records was right down the road from where I lived. And it was just like this old cool part of town in Memphis. So I'll never forget that. And living at the Waffle House, eating at the Waffle House 3 times a day. Cheers to the Waffle House. Scattered, smothered, covered. But those days I carry with me still, because it keeps me grateful and grounded for the life I have today. All right, what else do we got? Rock for president. Thank you. Every one day. Thank you. What's my favorite music? What's up, Russia? What quality do I admire most and respect most of my wife? That's a good question. Lewis Howell coming through with the great questions, man. Thank you. The quality that I love about my wife, Lauren, is... Come back to me with that, Wrestle with Andy. I want to see that question about Memphis. But I want to answer this one because it's important and because I think she's listening. and she's watching. The quality that I love about my wife, Lauren, is... She truly, truly, truly is the kindest, I mean kind from deep in the bones, mana, spirit, truly the kindest human being I've ever met. And that permeates, and that kind of spirit of kindness and warmth deep in the mana, in the soul, that permeates, and that's very powerful. That's very, very powerful. That's when you know, you can be famous, you could be not famous, you can be, from wherever you're at around the world, whatever your bank account says, who gives a shit? When somebody is kind and loving and warm, that's the kind of stuff that moves the world. That's the kind of stuff that really disrupts. So thank you for asking that question. I gained a lot of brownie points with that one, baby. But it's true. She's the best. Lucky man. All right. What do we got? Just got done watching Moana. Thank you for watching Moana. What can I say except you're welcome? So here's a funny story. So I was holding baby Tia today, and this is a true story. So I was, she loves when I, so we've gotten to a point now where I, when I wash her hands, as we are teaching our children to wash their hands, how important washing their hands is. We used to sing the ABCs to give them an idea of how long they need to wash their hands for. Then I thought, oh, well, what if we just tried the rap portion of Moana, of the song that I sing in Moana, called You're Welcome, and let's see how the timing is on that. So we started, and I started washing her hands, and now every time I pick her up, and every time we're in the kitchen together, is, Daddy, sing the song, Daddy, sing the song. And I'm like, you don't want to hear me say, okay, listen, honestly, kid, I could go on and on. I could explain every natural phenomenon. No, I won't do it now, but she loves it, and it drives me crazy because I can't stop rapping that. Lin-Manuel Miranda, thank you, brother, for writing that one. Cheers to you. All right. These are funny. Oh, that's a good. Oh, what's up, brother? Good to see you. You stay safe too, Crook Boys. 2000 Rock versus 1985 Ric Flair. Who goes over? That's good. Ric Flair, easy. Mel Chauncey, good to see you, brother. You're always an inspiration. Your story's an inspiration. Can't wait to show it to the world and tell it to the world. So speaking of Ric Flair, you guys have been asking me, like, who is on my Mount Rushmore professional wrestlers? I know, James, I know I only had one bite of this French toast. James J. Jefferson, good to see you, brother. My wrestling Mount Rushmore would be the immortal Hulk Hogan, the Nature Boy Ric Flair, the Texas Rattlesnake Steve Austin, and that fourth person I always kind of keep blank because I vacillate back and forth between Nature Boy Buddy Rogers, Bruno Sammartino, Randy Macho Man Savage, Dusty Rhodes. You know, it's hard to kind of quantify because you always want to pick people who have had the most impact on the wrestling business, who move the bottom line, but also most importantly, they just had this intangibleness X factor where they could connect with a crowd and connect with an audience. And the bottom line is with those three individuals that I mentioned, Hogan, Austin, and Flair, they really move the company's bottom line. They move the NWA's bottom line, the WWF and the WWE's bottom line. In terms of drawing power, these guys were the biggest draws in the history of professional wrestling. And that's all that matters. You know, you can have 15 world titles and 27 other kind of titles that you have these days, but the bottom line is how strong can you draw? And are you selling arenas out? And are you breaking records? Really, that's the bottom line. And those three guys have. I think Sammartino did for a very long time. Bob Backlund had an incredible run, too, as well. Where am I on Mount Rushmore? I would say I'm on the back of Mount Rushmore. That's the part you don't see. But I'm on the back there all by myself, and I'm raising my eyebrow, and I'm, if you smell, I'm doing all that shit. That's me on the back. Great question. The Terramana tequila bottle. Yes, I will tell you a little bit about the bottle. I'll show you guys here. So, all right. And I know I didn't dent this French toast, but I'll tell you about the Terramana tequila bottle. So we put a lot of effort and work into these Terramana tequila bottles. This is the Reposado. This is the Blanco. And, so what I wanted to do was I wanted the bottle to represent its founder, myself. Broad in the shoulder, little narrow at the hip. Depends on how much cheat meal I have and how much tequila I drink. A little bit wider in the neck, little thick neck here. But also for the bartenders out there, I wanted them to be able to grab on to the bottle here and be confident in grabbing it and make it feel like they're grabbing something substantial. and they're pouring, and wanted to make it easy for them. And I also wanted to create a bottle that wasn't your typical tequila bottle. And so I came up with this design, and it seems like a lot of people out there like it. And I'll give you a little tutorial on Terramana. Yes, Simi, we are soon, as soon as we can. So I'll give you a little bit of information, but here on the front of Terramana Tequila, you will see, so here are the blue agave. These are the agave fields. I don't know if you guys could see it right here. These are the agave fields in Jalisco, Mexico. These are our agave fields, our Terramana agave fields. High in the mountains of Jalisco. Our tequila is made at approximately, I think, about 7,500 feet up in elevation. And there's a lot of, like a little, a lot of cool little details here. So I don't know if you guys could see that. But right over here in the corner, and it's really subtle, this is the copper pot stills that we use. So in the world of tequila making, I go back a few years ago, I wanted to create a tequila. I have a, my palate for tequila is, it's of a pretty decent quality. So I started with the tequilas that I loved. This was about 5 years ago. And I use that as the, that was going to be our reference. So I wanted to make sure that the tequila was made of the highest quality. And as I started to understand the process of making tequila, you realize that the highest qualities, the most expensive tequilas, they use copper pot stills. So right there in the corner, there's our copper pot stills that we have at our Terramana distillery. And they are all made by hand. And when you actually go there, and I've spent time in Jalisco in our small town where we make at our distillery, at Terramana Distillery, they take a little hammer and they dent the entire copper pot still. Because what it does, when you dent it, it does this really cool thing to the fermentation, to the process of it, and it just adds a sweeter quality, a higher quality to the tequila. So I wanted to make sure that the that our copper pot stills are there. This NOM 1613. So the NOM, without getting too technical in tequila business, but what separates Terramana from the other tequilas around every tequila in the market is that our Terramana tequila at our Terramana distillery only makes Terramana tequila. So you could have a distillery that produces hundreds of tequilas from many, many different brands, but we are very proud of that. So Terramana, at our distillery, we only make Terramana. So it's our own NOM number. No one will ever share that. And on the back, we wanted to make sure that we had 100% transparency. What I found in the spirits world was I always thought, well, what am I drinking? And what's inside the Terramana, that, or what's inside the tequila in terms of ingredients, in terms of health facts, because I'm health conscious. So this tequila is 100% gluten-free. And on the back, for the very first time ever, we're completely transparent in showing you guys the calories, the carbohydrates, the sugar, as you will see. It is zero sugars, zero carbohydrates, gluten-free. So for the very first time, we have a tequila that, I just wanted to make sure that everybody knew what they were getting. One other thing that's very cool I want to show you guys. So as I went across the country to speak with our buyers and our distributors, from our big Walmart partners to our mom and pop businesses all across the country, I wanted them to know that I'm getting into the tequila business as a, this is a legacy for me. It's a legacy play for me. It's a legacy investment. This is not something that I want to build up in 5 years or 10 years and then sell it and then move on to the next thing. This is something that I want to build, and this is something that's important to me. And I want to hold on to it for the rest of my life. And I want to pass this on to my children and my children's children. So there's a little thing here on the bottom that a lot of bartenders and a lot of you guys have asked me about. You don't know what it is. Well, I'll show you what it is now. So embossed right there and it's kind of turned in many different ways, is the word Tijasi. And this embossment of Tijasi is the identifier and the indicator of my legacy, motivation. And Tijasi is combining the first three names of my children, of all my three daughters, Tiana, Jasmine, and Simone, Tijasi. So that is the indicator that it's all legacy. And so what I also wanted to do was the most important thing was to make sure that it was the highest of quality, made with the highest of quality from copper pot stills to brick oven roast for many, many days. And I wanted to make sure, most importantly, that everybody could afford it. So nobody's paying, nobody's overpaying, nobody is paying an arm and a leg. And I want to make sure that all you guys are able to afford it. So cheers. Hey, Brazil, good to see you. I have not put a dent in this French toast. I'm also getting texts from Lauren. Get your ass in the house. What do you think of Joe Exotic's go-to cheat meals? First of all, like a lot of you guys, I have been so fascinated with Tiger King on Netflix. And I just finished it last night, and I was really quite blown away. I mean, you know, these cast of characters that you find. I came up in the world of professional wrestling. There are many characters like Joe Exotic in the world of pro wrestling, especially when I came up in the world of pro wrestling, and especially because, again, I grew up in it, so from the 70s and 80s. But what was most, I think, revealing about that docu-series was the was it really the treatment of animals and the treatment of these really big, beautiful cats. And, you know, it's hard to say who's doing right by the animals, who's not doing right by the animals. But I try to underreact when I see things. So who knows? I don't know. Who's right, who's wrong, who's lying, who's not lying. But I can tell you I was thoroughly entertained. I mean, up to 3 o'clock in the morning watching that. So, and so much so that I called my agent and I said, brother, get me the rights to this because I want to make this movie. I think $7 can really produce something special and something revealing and informative and entertaining and really dig into these human beings who have just led this insane life. And then he said, no, can't do it. Somebody else snatched the rights up. I was like, ah, shit. All right. Well, somebody else will make that movie. But anyway, yeah, I was fascinated by that. No, I have not put a dent in this. Been drinking. We all know who is wrong, James. Yes, can't wait for the Smashing Machine 2 as well. Smashing Machine, I think, as a lot of you guys know, that is a documentary that I saw, and I cannot wait to make that movie. It's based on one of the founding fathers of MMA and UFC. His name is Mark Kerr, heavyweight, who had just gone through an incredible a journey in his life of addiction, being down, depression, and then being the greatest in the world. He's still alive today, and I can't wait to make that movie. All right, so we're going to wrap this up because I got about half a bottle of Terramana that I'm going to kill. And so before we do that, let's see. Is there anything else? What's up, Sadiq? Good to see you, brother. Keep working hard. I know you are. Thank you for watching my movies. I appreciate it. Love you back. Thank you. Who would play The Rock if there was a movie about your life? No idea. I have no idea. I think it would have to be me. What's your secret talent and skill that no one knows that you have? My secret talent. Well, Let's see. Well, I can't really show you because it leads to making babies. Guys, it's just a tequila talking at this point. It's just a Terramana talking. So this thing says that I have 7 seconds remaining. I just want to see what happens. Thank you for bearing with me. It's the very first time I've done IG Live.